Yo, what's up, and welcome back to another episode of The Movie Newbie. I'm your host, Jibril Ishaimi, and this time we are minus one member, but plus a cooler member.
What we've lost in Raf, we've gained in Naringa.
Yeah.
I like
Hello,
that.
Naringa. How about, let's introduce Naringa first.
Yeah.
Yeah, because she's also the myth, not the man.
The myth, the woman.
The woman, the myth, the legend, Naringa. How would you say hello?
Hello, and labas.
Labas. What does labas mean?
It's hello.
In what language?
In Lithuanian.
In Lithuanian.
Ooh, yeah.
Yeah.
So Naringa has been on this podcast, I think, twice before. So this is your three-peat?
Yeah, yeah.
The return?
The return?
Yeah.
The return of the Naringa. Yeah. The Naringa of Azkaban.
Yeah, I like that. Hi. I don't know if I need to introduce myself again. I didn't really prep an introduction.
We it's always awkward when we are introduced. Yeah. Raf and I'm always really awkward when.
Or can I introduce myself as the woman who needs no introduction?
Sure.
Ah, I sure. Like that. Yeah,
that's
absolutely.
She needs no introduction.
Yeah.
That works.
The Naringa.
Yeah.
The Naringa.
How many Naringas do you know?
Just one.
Exactly.
Just the one.
Just the one.
Exactly.
Yeah. But yeah, Raf couldn't join us for boring reasons related to Thanksgiving, otherwise known as the celebration of the destruction and robbing of Native American people's land. But whatever, it's cool if you celebrate that.
Yeah.
And it's cool if you bail on your duties.
I think what they celebrate is Friendsgiving, and they, I don't know if it's Thanksgiving or Friendsgiving, but whatever.
Yeah.
Why am I talking?
No.
See people and
no?
And eat food. Like, you know, British people also have some weird things they celebrate, like Guy Fawkes Night.
Yeah. That's true. Yeah, you that's know? True. Yeah. Celebrating the I guess the burning at the stake
the
of
plan,
a terrorist.
Yeah.
Or the plan to burn Parliament.
Yeah. And then like I was talking with a few friends the other day and we're trying to figure out what Boxing Day was. Do you know
why,
what that is?
Why is it called Boxing Day?
Or what it like what
oh,
was
man,
it?
This is one of the there's always in like a Christmas cracker trivia.
Oh yeah.
And I never remember I've definitely read the explanation,
right.
But I don't know.
Because I've gotten loads of different things of when I went on Google and checked it out. But one of the explanations was it was the day you go fox hunting after Christmas. Not sure if that's real. The second thing was it was the day that you go and give leftover food to the poor.
I think I heard that one.
The third one
is like...
Oh, so
you put it in boxes, then, the food.
Possibly. The third one was, like, things that didn't get sold for Christmas are sold for, like, a discount on Boxing Day, which is kind of like Black Friday, I guess. I don't know. There were a bunch of different things like that. But, anyways, we digress. Today, we're closing off the Korean New Wave theme. And we're doing the film Burning, but I don't know much about this. Ollie probably knows a little bit more. So how about you introduce the film to everyone?
Sure. So, yeah, I'm really excited to talk about this one, but just a quick little introduction. Burning is a 2018 psychological thriller written, produced, and directed by Mr. Lee Chang-dong. He's a fantastic filmmaker. I suggest you seek out his other work if you enjoyed this. It's based on the short story Barn Burning, written by Haruki Murakami, a very famous Japanese novelist, with elements inspired by William Faulkner's story of the same name. It stars a couple of actors that are very well known in Korea, but for an international audience, the most notable name, most likely, would be Steven Yeun.
Mm-hmm.
And the plot depicts a young delivery man who runs into his childhood friend and how they meet an enigmatic young man named Ben soon after, who Jong-soo becomes suspicious of and begins to believe is in danger. Sorry, I kind of butchered that little summary there. But anyway, it's a psychological mystery film.
Yeah.
And I'll just give my quick thoughts on the film and why I chose it before handing it over to you guys. This film has kind of haunted me. It has lived rent-free in my brain ever since I saw it. I watched it with my younger brother in the cinemas in Institute of Contemporary Art, ISA.
Right.
In London, it's in Marble Arch.
Just a quick question.
Sure.
Same year as Parasite?
So I
or
think
same
it,
year as
I think it was released in South Korea, or it premiered in 2018. I think I watched it early 2019 when it was released.
Okay.
In the West internationally. But yeah, I am. And this film has had a really profound effect on me. I think it's one of those films where when for the, it's quite a long film and it's definitely a slow burn. So you're watching it for 2.5 hours and up until the very end, or I think even afterwards, until you've had a moment to digest it, you're thinking, why are we watching a lot of this? Why is any of this significant? And it's one of those films where once you get to the end and it really dawns on you what this film's about, or at least this was my reaction anyway, everything that you've seen is like a puzzle piece that fits to make a picture that isn't actually clear. And that's what I really love about this film, is that it's about so many things depending on how you interpret it. It's all about what's there and what isn't there. There's a crucial scene early on where Haimi's character does a mime with a tangerine. And I think that tells you everything you need to know about the film. She says the tangerine is there, it isn't there. So Haimi has been murdered, she hasn't been murdered. Ben is real, he isn't real. You know, everything could be interpreted from a different angle and you could come to so many different conclusions. But I also think it's a really interesting commentary on South Korean culture, on masculinity, on class. I really love this film. I do think it is a masterpiece and probably in my top 10 films of like the last, I don't know, 20 years.
Wow.
So yeah, a bit of a hyperbolic reaction, but those are my initial thoughts anyway. I want to hand it over to you guys next, but I want to get our guests' thoughts first.
Yeah, hard to follow that one. This was my first time watching it, and we watched it together. And as you said, it's a very slow burn kind of film. And I think it was one of those things where like we finished watching it and I was thinking about it after like a couple of days afterwards and just trying to like understand and everything that happened. And I think, as I said before, I feel like multiple viewings would give you so many like different things that you didn't notice in the first one. And it's very intricate. And I liked what you said about like the pantomime thing. And I think it's more about what's there, what isn't there. It's like, it's how you tell a story. Everything in exactly. That is like how, like everything that, like all of your preconceptions about certain things like are going to influence what you think is going to happen. So it's like you take some vague facts and you bring it together from the way that like you understand it or you perceive it, you know? Because from my perspective as a woman, I feel like, yeah, Ben definitely killed her, you know? It's like he's a predator, she's gone, he killed her, you know? It's what you believe in and what you think. And it's like that little piece of evidence you need to be like, oh yes, this is the truth, therefore it is. Because nothing is in the movie is clear. Everything is so vague that you can interpret it in so many different ways. It's like an open book almost.
Absolutely.
Yeah, 100%. So yeah, I really loved what both of you said, particularly what you said about like you're looking for pieces of the puzzle that makes an unclear image. Is that, I think you said something like that. So that makes a lot of sense for me, but it kind of, I hated that, you know, like I hated the fact that it was such a long, it's not that I don't like this film. I really enjoyed this film. I thought it was an incredibly beautiful film. The performances from the three actors were just incredible. I thought their characters really shone through in the way that they performed them, you know, like from what's the main character's name? He was so physical with the way
Jung-Soo?
He walked. Yeah, Jung-Soo.
Yeah,
Jung-Soo. His performance, incredible. Haimi, I also really enjoyed the way that she kind of played I don't know how to explain the kind of character, but like someone that definitely Ollie would fall in love with, I think.
Well, she's a manic pixie girl, and it makes so much sense that like it's based on a Murakami story. Yeah. Even though I love Murakami as a writer, he does not know how to write women.
But I think this seems like it's too easily giving excuses to the writers or to the filmmakers here. But I think she is kind of portrayed like a manic pixie dream girl. But this is a film almost entirely told from the perspective of this young man who I don't think we necessarily can believe is a particularly good person either.
No.
So the fact that she's kind of seen, like you said, as the kind of character that I might fall in love with when I was younger.
Yeah, yeah.
Or someone, you know, for example, like Kate Winslet in Eternal Sunshine or Zooey Deschanel in 500 Days of Summer.
Scott Pilgrim, what's her name?
Yeah, Ramona Flowers in Scott Pilgrim. Yeah. Definitely. I think that it ultimately makes sense because you're seeing the film from this very blinkered perspective.
Yeah.
Yeah, but still, like, we've seen so many of those women. Can we not make them in any way better and less like this, you know, flowy woman who like takes her top off and starts dancing after smoking a joint, which never would happen, by the way.
Yeah, you know,
it's like there is like realistic manic pixie girl behavior, and then there's stuff that is just like a little bit too much, you know?
So it was definitely like that was one thing that I was kind of like, is this completely necessary? I was like, this is definitely written by men, like filmed by men. Like, this is definitely from the point of view of a man. So, it wasn't really a bad thing necessarily for what the movie was trying to achieve. But what I'm trying to say is that it was just way too long. Like, I found it difficult to have the, how do I say it? The reward of what happened at the end of the film wasn't enough for me sitting through this entire film. So, there's things about it that I didn't like, and that's probably the main thing. Don't get me wrong, I still enjoyed the watch. I just think 2 hours and a half is way too long for what was on the page. Yeah, what was on the page, yeah.
I would agree. I definitely felt like some bits weren't necessary to show. Like, some things could definitely be edited and shortened and still have the same kind of effect on the audience.
Yeah,
I mean, I can understand that. And look, if that's your gut reaction, I get it. If it's not really engaging the whole way through, I understand it. And it's certainly a slow burn, but I think... And I think it's pointless for me to say, but if you watch it a second time, it really comes together. That's a very annoying... those are very annoying words to hear from somebody who's trying to convince you to like something they like. Like, you need to give it a rewatch,
It reminds me of a film, and it reminds me of the exact feeling that I had during that film. And it's that one, I can't remember what it's called, but I think it's got like Will Smith in it, and he kills himself he kills himself.
Oh, it's the one with the dough where he like donates his organs.
He donates his eyes and he donates parts of his body.
This is with Will Smith?
Yeah. And with, what's her name?
Oh, is this 7 pounds?
Yes.
7 pounds.
I've never even seen it, but somehow I just saw the poster in my mind.
So
when you were
it reminds me of that film because I remember the entire, and people walked out like halfway through the film because they was like, what is going on? And then it like in the last 20 minutes, there's a reward of like, oh, okay, this is all the puzzle pieces falling into place. And that's the kind of the same thing that I felt for this film where I was like, oh, I see the puzzle pieces falling into place, but you said it perfectly. It fell into place, but the image that was made up is still unclear.
After
watching the film and thinking about it, I was still like, I don't have the pieces to make a clear judgment on like how it ends.
What I like about it is not that you can put the pieces together and figure out what happened. The point is that anything could have happened really, and there's no direct conclusion or clear. You're not left. You can't leave this story with a clear understanding of what happened.
Yeah.
Like if you go online, people have theories, very specific theories as to what exactly happened. But it doesn't matter because there's not enough evidence to support any one conclusion.
Yeah.
And that's what I love about it is that you can create so many different kinds of stories. You said it's about, it's kind of like this, what the story is depends on who's telling it or how you're telling it. And that's what I love about this film is that it's all about how stories can change depending on which angle you look at it from. I will say this though, that I think I found it quite, I wasn't bored watching it the first time or in subsequent viewings, just because I think the mystery that it puts in front of you of what happened to Amy was interesting enough, at least, that it kept me engaged. But I can understand people being disappointed by the ending because they're expecting a more familiar ending that you might expect from a mystery film or from a whodunit or a murder mystery, where you're going to find out who did it, what happened to Amy. But you don't get that. What you just get is a really you know, extraordinary act of violence, basically, between two men. Yeah. Anyway, I mean, this is what I love about the film is that even if you didn't like it a lot,
conversation,
it can engender a lot of conversation. Mm-hmm, but mm-hmm. On that note, should we get to favorite scene?
Let's do it.
Does anyone want to go first? Naringa?
Yeah, sure. I can go first. Even though I didn't, again, it was the scene where Hami is dancing topless in the field. And even though I hated that, like, you know, she smoked a joint and like immediately went off, took off her top and started dancing, that was like really stupid. And I didn't think that, like, the depiction of smoking weed was very real.
Yeah.
But the visual aspect of that scene was so beautiful. Mm-hmm. And like, I feel like I've not seen that before. And it was just so, I don't know, just looked so amazing and ethereal. Is that the word?
Ethereal, yeah.
That I was like, wow, this is a really beautiful piece of filmmaking.
Yeah.
And also, if you know anything about filmmaking, that whole scene, not just that scene, but them smoking weed and chatting outside beforehand, it all takes place during twilight, during the magic hour, which means pain in the ass to shoot, because they would have had to shoot that over many, many days, most likely, because you've basically got that light for about maybe 25, 30 minutes max before it goes, and you want to get it in sequence as well. So yeah, but very striking visually.
Yeah. So yeah, a lot of the scenes in this film is just, that's the perfect word, ethereal. Like even the sex scene, their first sex scene, or no, their only sex scene.
I think, they only have sex once.
They only have sex once, right.
And yet he's like, she's mine, which I think is an interesting.
And you know what I thought when I was watching that scene? I was like, he looks like he doesn't know how to kiss well.
I think that he was directed that way. I think that's intentional.
Performance was so physical. He barely knows how to walk.
Yeah.
You know? Like, he's just like a...
There's something very animalistic about him.
In Arabic, we call a person like that loferi. I don't know if it's like actually an English word made Arabic. Anyways.
But what does it mean?
It's that kind of guy who, you know, kind of like doesn't give a shit about what they wear, slouches, kind of like drags their feet. Yeah. You know, even the way they drink, they're like, it's
sloppy.
Sloppy kind of, but it's not sloppy. I don't know. Anyways, I really liked, now I can't even remember what I was going to say. The first sex scene, I thought that entire like thing where he comes into the house, they like talk about the cat and like, is like, ooh, what cat is she talking about? Is she talking about her hoo-ha, or is she talking about like an actual pet,
or does she even have a cat, because we never see the cat?
Yeah, because you never see the cat, exactly.
But you see the poo though, like that's a lot of effort to find some cat's poo and put it
definitely has a cat, but you just don't know if the cat at the end that we see is her cat.
At that moment where they have sex, he doesn't see the cat poo. That's when he tries to feed the cat, and then he finds out later that there was a cat there or whatever. But I just really like the thing where she looks outside the window, and as you see the light hit the tower and it comes and it shines on the wall. I don't know if you guys have ever felt that living in London, but like in my old flat, there was a specific time of day where this is the only sunlight, natural light that you get in the house. And that hit home for me. And I thought it was really nice that when they were having sex, that was what he was focusing on, or at least... I don't know. What?
I was going to ask, like, did it hit home to you in the same way when he would, like, come back to the flat and masturbate at that exact same time?
Yeah, that was the weird thing where I was like,
I think it's really interesting. I think it's, I mean, you could look at that as, like, kind of a pretentious choice because you're not entirely sure why he's doing that. But I think you could interpret that as, like, a commentary again on the class, the sort of class envy or the class aspirations, because Hami and Jong-Soo are both from working class families from the countryside.
Yeah, from the countryside.
Whereas Ben is this mysteriously wealthy, well-educated, seemingly international person. But basically, the Soul Tower is where the light bounces off of. She describes that. And the Soul Tower is like, I guess you could look at that as a symbol of wealth and aspirations.
Right.
And so yet she's living in this tiny one-bedroom, one-room flat.
Mm-hmm.
She's in a ton of credit card debt. Yet he masturbates to looking outside at the tower. And when they're having sex, he's staring at this light that for one brief yeah. moment of the day, reflects from mm-hmm. the Soul Tower, from the skyscraper, into the Pokey
yeah.
Flat.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry. I think you were saying that scene as well is kind of strange and ethereal in the same way that the dancing in the twilight is.
Yeah, and like a lot of the scenes in this film are kind of like that, where it's just, I don't know, it just seems kind of like a hazy dream in a way.
Yeah.
But yeah, what about you?
I mean, I'll throw in a different choice, but I want to quickly talk about the dancing scene.
I have a sneaky the dancing scene.
Sure. Well, I was gonna pick another scene, but I just wanted to quickly comment on that. First of all, Miles Davis is the soundtrack.
Yep.
Incredible album. Yep. That's his score to a French movie called Lift to the Scaffolds. And I think it really complements that scene beautifully. But also, like, her, I could totally understand why a scene of this attractive manic pixie dream girl taking her clothes off and dancing after one hit of a joint in front of two guys reeks of something that was written by a man. And this was written by men, so that's totally true. But I feel like it's really tragic as well, because someone says early on, when you're a woman in South Korea, which is a very patriarchal society from what I understand, it's really hard to exist because you're expected to be two things at once. You're expected to be pretty, beautiful, flirtatious, but you're also expected to be chaste, and you're not yeah. expected to be a slut, which is what she's called yeah. by this character.
And as you see with the dynamic with the two men, like it also goes with class. Well, not so much class, I guess, but with age and like
yeah.
your seniority in work. So that's why he asked, like, oh, how old is Ben? And it was like, oh, 6 or 7 years older than you. So he has this like forced
like deference or reverence
yeah.
towards
yeah.
him. Yeah.
But I think that, I don't know. I mean, it's perhaps a fair point, but I feel like that movie is not really about women in any meaningful way. It's more about like men's reactions. One thing I did like thought about when I watched the movie, and I don't know if like you've noticed that, she says when she meets him that she had plastic surgery because mm-hmm. he called her ugly.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, then it comes into a question of like, you know, is that her revenge? Sleeping with him once and then having someone else and then completely disappearing and then, you know, having him question or like actually looking after her cat who might not even be there.
I think that's one interpretation, which would be, some people have argued, do we even know this is Haimi? Because he doesn't recognize her because she supposedly had
exactly.
plastic surgery. But he also doesn't have nearly any memories of anything she describes, like yeah. the well or the moment when he called her ugly. He has yeah. no memory of any of this. So you could,
yeah.
and we never see anyone else from her life look at her and call her a Haimi.
Mm-hmm.
So no one from her past is ever around to confirm that this is
yeah.
her. So, you know, anyway, it's again, you can go down the rabbit hole so many times.
Yeah.
But I'll just quickly say as a different scene, I really love the dancing scene. It's obviously very memorable, but also the final scene, which if Raph was here, I think he would shout out because most of it is a single take, which Raph loves. But I just think it's really haunting the way he, it's snowing at that point, and when he stabs him, and then when Ben tries to get back into his car, and he stabs him again, and it's the first time you see Ben cry. And
yeah.
Ben had said earlier, his character had said that he's never cried in his
yeah.
life. And he almost, in a way, he embraces him when he's being stabbed at the
yeah.
end, which almost felt like you could interpret that as, you got me, or it could be, thank you for releasing
yeah.
me.
I think what
yeah.
made it really effective, and I don't know if it was planned, but right before he was going to stab the guy, a truck
yeah.
drives by, and then he kind of has to act, or I think he gets stabbed already, and he like tries to cover
yes.
the dead body.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
yeah. Yeah, that's a beautiful scene, I think.
And then when
really
he's driving
great.
In the car naked afterwards, and
yeah.
you see the fire in the,
yeah.
in the reflection of the rearview window.
One thing I'll say about Ben crying, though, I feel like... interesting connection there, but I feel like when he was saying, oh, I've never cried, is more about emotional crying. That I don't think that was perhaps an emotional crying.
No,
that was
no.
more of
you're
like, I've been stabbed and like
yeah.
it fucking hurts, you
yeah,
know?
Yeah, yeah.
So
course.
It's,
of
I
course.
Feel like maybe he was like, him referring to not crying means more of like, I've not cried emotionally because.
Yeah, of course.
That's
yeah.
the.
No, definitely.
So, that's so funny. It just, I recently watched bits of Andrew Tate and Pierce Morgan, and there's like an extended bit where Andrew Tate is like, I didn't cry in prison. I don't cry. I just had an emotional tear like stream down my face. And it's just
an emotional tear. Well, what else is a tear?
I don't know. It's the kind of like stupid, like toxic male traits about like, so I get what, like Ben, for example, like this whole like toxic masculinity where he's like, I'm cool. I'm a man.
I don't cry.
Yeah, I don't cry. Like I've never cried in my life.
And the way he comes across like a sociopath because he's, she's crying because she's talking essentially about having, I think, suicidal thoughts.
Yeah.
Or questioning her existence because she's describing those feelings she has when she saw the sunset and the dancing. And he just like laughs at her and he's like, it's so fascinating when people cry.
Yeah.
And similarly, he laughs when when Jong-Soo tells him, I'm in love with Haemi. And Ben just like laughs in his face.
Yeah. Yeah. He plays a really good asshole.
I think it's very good.
It's actually one of the best assholes I've ever seen because it's so understated.
Yeah.
It's so like quietly and like quietly asshole, you know? It's like very, he's not like, you know, very vocal or, you know, I don't know what it is about him, but he's like so like low-key the worst.
Yeah.
Which kind of makes him like the perfect villain because he's like this.
Well, the worst like rival as well, like romantic rival.
Yeah.
Because he's everything that Jong-Soo is not. He's like perfectly groomed. He's so well-dressed. He listens to jazz in his apartment while cooking pasta, which I thought was a funny line as well.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty funny too. Or like just even being in like the swanky neighborhood and like near Gangnam or whatever it is. It's exactly like you said. This movie springs like conversation. Just before we move on to performances, because I feel like it's a good segue. I do love, I guess you can't really call it a scene, but the shot of Jong-Soo going to look for Haemi, and she goes to the mime class, and there's basically the guys, like all the people dancing, I don't know, miming.
Sure.
And then it's just a single shot, doesn't move, of these people miming in a dark room. Lighting is incredibly beautiful. All of a sudden, you see a door open, light shines through. Jong-Soo comes in, and then the teacher comes over while the mimes are like, I can't remember if they're moving or...
I think they continue.
Yeah. And they just have a conversation and they go back to this like silent movement. I don't know. It's just such a beautiful scene.
I completely agree.
Or not a scene, I guess, like a...
Just an image.
Sequence, yeah. So I just wanted to put that there. But let's do performances. We spoke about Steven Yeun. And for me, that was my favorite performance, I think. Out of the trio, all of them were excellent. Yeah. It's hard to pick one.
But I agree. Steven was mine, too. Because I've seen him in other stuff before. Like, the first time I saw him was in... The Walking Dead.
Have you seen him in anything that's also mainly Korean?
I've seen actually. That was the first time. And it was...
Same here.
It was so interesting because I was like, he looks so much more Korean.
Wait, Demi, you've seen Minari?
Yeah, I've seen Minari.
That's in Korean.
But he plays an American.
No, he plays a Korean guy.
Yeah, film. Yeah. Oh, famously...
Did not like that movie.
I hate Minari. I think it's one of the worst films I've ever seen in the last 5 years.
Wow.
Yeah. It's so boring.
Have you seen you haven't seen Minari?
I don't think so, no.
Okay, but you saw him first in The Walking Dead.
In The Walking Dead, I really liked his character, and I just liked him as an actor in general. But in this role, as I said, like, that character was just so amazing, so well done. As I said, like, the best thing about it was just, like, the understated assholeness of him, you know? It was never, like, in your face. It was never, like... obvious. It was just like the way he would look at people, way he would treat people with niceness, but something sinister underneath, you know. It was like that. Yeah, I thought that character was really, really cool, and it made me hate him so much as well. So
yeah
I remember we were watching this together, Nuring and I, and I think just at one point shortly after his character's introduced, he just turned to me, he's like, this guy is such an asshole. I would. I mean, have you guys both? Would you guys both?
If I could, I would give all three of them
Yeah, I mean, I'll name the other actors just because I feel like they deserve a shout out here. So John Jong Seo, who plays Haemi, this is her first time ever acting in a film.
Oh wow!
She's a complete unknown when she was.
Is she like
this.
A K-pop?
No.
She's completely unknown.
Just picked completely out of obscurity. Which,
damn.
And I think what she accomplishes with this character is really wonderful. But yeah. I would go with Yoo Ah In, who plays Jong Soo. Because I think you nailed it at the beginning when you said he just got such a physical performance.
Yeah.
And what's crazy is if you look at pictures of the actor who plays him, so he's actually a massive K-drama star. He's massive in Korea.
Oh, okay.
Although I think he's embroiled in a drug scandal recently. But
oh shit.
And you see pictures of him and he just looks like one of the guys from BTS. He's like really handsome, really beautiful and well put together, and he's like a model.
If you
but
could
in
compare
this film,
him to
looks...
like a Western actor, what kind of who would he be?
I mean, I'm not.
He's like
as,
a heartthrob.
Kind like, of. He's like a Tom Holland or something.
Okay.
You know, or
okay.
like a Timothy Chalamet or
okay,
something. Maybe.
Okay.
He was. He's been popular for like a decade in South Korea. He was like a teen actor, I think.
Right.
And yet he's really. You believe him as this really. I mean. I don't know if you would go so far as to call him, he's not ugly, but he's just very plain looking. And more importantly, he's like ill-mannered sort of, or he's got quite childish mannerisms.
Yeah.
And he's got like no guile whatsoever.
Mm.
And so I thought it was a really good performance. And there's this one scene in particular where like he's quite a monosyllabic person in general. Like he doesn't betray a lot of emotion or complexity. But there's this scene where you realize the effect of this disappearance has had on him, where he's describing, you know, when he goes to her sister's restaurant, Haemi's sister's restaurant, and he's talking about the well, and they're like, that never happened. But he's describing it, and then all of a sudden his eyes well up with tears.
Yeah.
He's just like, I'm sorry, I'm just realizing what that must have felt like to be in the well.
Yeah.
And I just think it's a really beautiful moment.
He
performs it so well.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anywho, favorite quote.
Oh, there was
I
so
have
many.
This one
Wait,
actually.
Yeah,
because I wrote it down, and it's from Haemi's flat, and you're introducing your poop first when he doesn't see the cat, but he sees the poop first, and I thought that was really funny. So that's my favorite quote.
That's good. I struggled with this actually because. It's hard to remember quotes when you're reading subtitles. And then I looked and then I was like, so I tried to look up subtitles online. There is nothing.
You know what's funny? I didn't even know that was one of the questions in the new seasons, like favorite quote. But when we were watching, I wrote it down because I just thought it was so hilarious.
Oh, that's great.
So,
I mean, there were quotes that I wanted to remember, but I couldn't because it would have required going back and watching the film again. And I just didn't have time. But I found this one quote that I liked. It's when it's not the full quote that I want, but it's when they're sitting outside in the suns during sunset, and Ben's character says, "The morality of nature is like simultaneous existence." And then he says something like, he's like, "I'm here in Panju, I'm also in Seoul. I'm here, I'm not here."
Mm-hmm.
And again, I think that just plays into the theme of the movie, is that two things can exist at once, basically. It just depends on where you're watching it from.
Yeah.
And that's a chilling moment when he's talking about the barn burning as well.
Mm.
But what about you?
The greenhouse burning.
Oh, sorry. You're at greenhouse,
greenhouse
burning.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
sorry.
Greenhouse.
Yes, correct.
Not going to lie. I did not prepare one.
That's totally
fine. From watching the film. I remember being like, that's a quote. And then I forgot it. Let me think if I can get one off the top of my head.
I mean, it's hard to beat my one. I'm sorry.
Yeah,
yours,
no, that was a good
yours
one.
Was
that was a good one. Yeah.
It was just so funny.
It's like one of the rare, like laugh out loud moments.
Yeah.
Or like comedic beats in this entire film. Yeah.
Well, sorry, fans. I've let you down. Movie newbie listeners. I can't think of one. But I guess we could. I'm going to switch it out for my favorite Jung Soo mannerism, and it was basically the moment where he was trying to get into Haemi's apartment after like she disappeared, after he called her a whore basically, and she kind of got killed, I guess.
Well, we don't know that.
We don't
she
know.
Could've,
yeah, she could have just left.
Peaced.
Yeah, she could have just peaced out.
I think Ben killed her.
I think, yeah. Yeah.
Or Ben, do you want to hear a really interesting theory?
What's
that, up? That's floated around before?
Mm.
Because, you know, there's that, we haven't talked about this yet, but crucially, there's a point in the film where it switches from his perspective to Ben's.
Yeah.
Where you see Ben putting the makeup on that girl, mm-hmm, on that woman.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And you realize that maybe Ben has this modus operandi where he finds lower class women or mm-hmm. working class women.
Yeah.
And basically trots them out in front of his wealthier friends.
Yeah.
To kind of make fun of them, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
But what if he helps these women disappear because they've got lots of credit card debt? What if he, like, maybe. Provides a service where he helps them get plastic surgery, change their identities, and disappear?
Or maybe, I think that's too nice of him. I don't think also, he's that kind of a guy. And also, Haimi had surgery before she met him. So
yeah. But what if we don't know that for sure. What if her and Ben knew each other before she met Jong-soo yeah. at the beginning?
Also, it could be, like, reverse, like, South Korea thing. Because there is a thing in Korea where North Korean operatives try to bring South Koreans into North Korea.
And they're living on the border of North Korea. You're yeah, hearing they, I didn't even think sirens. About
that. And he's like, oh, what is that sound? I don't know. Derpa, derpa, derpa. Yeah. No, but there was a... So I guess I'm going to change the quote to mannerisms. But there was a bit where he was, like, getting visibly more frustrated trying to get into her flat. And I thought that was, like, some of the best physical... Like one of the best physical yeah. performances yeah. I've seen. Yeah. So.
Or just even him, like, jogging. Like, he's, like, the most lazy. He's, like, the most, so like, sloppy angry. Jogger. He's, like, he looks like he's, obviously, he's wearing way too many clothes to jog.
I'm sure everyone, if they saw themselves jog, they'd be like, Jesus
I know,
Christ.
But he's got, like, the most, like, haphazard, like, dragging yeah. his body, basically, oh, yeah, across the
I
road.
I know guys from National Service who used to, it's basically, they really just, their body just does not want to do it, but they yeah. would basically get put into detention barracks if they didn't. So it's like someone who's, like, taking everything they can to just, like, do it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyways.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, good shout.
Armchair.
Armchair moment. So it'll be a quick one for me. I don't really have any armchair mm-hmm. moments. I mean, obviously, I think, yes, you're completely right. You could watch this film and think about, what if we actually didn't make the one female character a sort of an object of affection or sort of an object of mystery? But I love this film so much, so I can't really offer any critiques. So I'll just hand it over to you guys.
I mean, I'll use that scene because... I don't know, like, at this point in
which
20,
scene, sorry?
Just her being, like, so manic pixie girl. Like, I feel like in this day and age, in 2023, like, we can do better. We had, like, so many, like, shitty women characters. Like, it's not that easy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You can still have that kind of, like, I don't know, quirky or this kind of female that has impact and not make her completely mm-hmm. two-dimensional or completely just, like, this, you know, floaty... weird kind of
I
thing.
I think she's like possibly the deepest character out of.
Oh yeah,
like, I don't. Well, I don't talks find about the her... little hunger and the great hunger.
Yeah,
and like Jong-soo's just like a dullard to use.
Yeah,
a
yeah,
movie
but, yeah, literally.
And Ben is like a creepy,
yeah,
potential sociopath who has like no interiority.
But her speaking about that doesn't really give her the depth as well because yeah, the way yeah. she's talking and like when she's telling that story, she's like. The laughing stock of his Ben's friends, you know, like people yeah. are looking at her and like, oh, she's so weird. She's like, so I don't know. I just feel like her character just could have been more. And again, like not to take away from anything that happens in the movie, you could still have the same effect, but just like give someone a little bit more, you know, to work with. Because... Yeah, it's always like the men who have like really interesting, amazing characters and women are always left with just like something that's scratching the surface. So
or like masturbatory fantasy.
Exactly.
Yeah. She literally is because he's masturbating.
Yeah. Exactly. Room. Exactly. So, yeah.
Have you guys read the book?
No.
No.
The short story?
Yeah, or is it a short story?
No, I read the Faulkner story that the
right.
Murakami story was based on, right. but not the... Murakami one.
Was that the Faulkner story that Ben was reading?
I think he might have just been reading a collection of his stories right. or a biography of Faulkner right. or one of his novels.
Okay. Well, because like I don't know what the female character like if her character like to me it didn't seem flat. Like I thought that the way her character was written was it made sense for the plot. Like, the fact that she was mysterious and nobody knew who she was or, like, what exactly was going through her head. I think, like, it... Because we were from the point of view of Ben and Jung-Soo, and they both didn't really know what was going on. But I do understand the whole... Like, I think for me, it was just, like, the nudity. I was like, you don't need that to capture, like...
Yeah.
I don't think it was necessary to move the plot along. Like, you could have easily
she
have
could have
done
danced
it.
With her t-shirt on would have been
yeah or even like the whole dancing thing it's again it's just like not that she was like necessarily flat but again it's just she was different than both of them and again it's like that kind of I don't know I guess the best way to describe it is the manic pixiness of her like this girl that might you know change me or like inspire me to do something or whatever it's and Murakami like as much as I love him, like, he is not the best at writing women.
No, okay. This is pretty characteristic of his work, where a woman only exists to add mystery to the life of the protagonist.
And serve the man's story, you know, which Haimi is exactly what she's doing in this as well.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
Yeah, see, like, I'm not very familiar with Murakami stuff, so I can't really comment on that. But I feel like for this film, her character, where I just didn't like the fact that she... It's more of just like the plot itself where I was like, she kind of disappeared and I wanted more from her character because I was looking for more from her character. It's not that it was a badly written character for me. It was just like I was so interested in who she was that I wanted to know more. But that wasn't the main armchair moment for me. So for number one, too long, way too long. Two, Haimi's character, as in I wanted more of her and I didn't get that. And then the third thing is, which was actually the two moments where they speak about the African people, where they're like the Great Hunger and blah blah blah, and the new girlfriend where she speaks about Chinese people. And I thought that was a very how do I say caricature-ish, like the way that the language was used. I was just like, that's kind of, that for me was more of a thing that shouldn't happen these days.
Was that like verging on like racism in a way? Like,
do you mean the way the characters were talking about other cultures?
Yeah,
like Chinese and African
people? Yeah, yeah. And like kind of like this whole like, oh, the small hunger and the big hunger. And in a way, it's kind of like how you have like fake spirituality in the West, in Western films, where they kind of like make Asian culture kind of seem like, oh, it's this weird like mystical kind of thing. I just, in any aspect, I don't really resonate with that. And because it happens so early in the film, where she talks about like the Bushmen and how like there's like, I don't know if that's even real, this whole like, oh, there's either they're hungry for food or they're hungry for life. Although, in a weird way, the story of that story and Jung-Soo's journey throughout this film kind of goes from him like wanting something small into him trying to find the meaning of this entire issue. So, yeah, I do have issues with this film, but it does require more watches.
I'd even if you might have found some aspects of the film painful, maybe in a couple of years, I'd suggest revisiting it if you have the time.
Yeah.
And there's some really wonderful writing on and journalism on the film online, which I found to be very enlightening. But I completely, all those criticisms are really valid. I can't really argue against them. Okay. Well, should we move on to mystery question?
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a silly question. it's just hard when you got a movie like this where there's, you know, it's so overbearingly grim. It's just like with Old Boy. You kind of have to focus on the lighter stuff anyway. So you have a character here who's unrecognizable because she has had plastic surgery. And, you know, we don't know what she looked like before, but supposedly, at least she seems to think that this plastic surgery has made her beautiful, even though she's unrecognizable. And we do know that South Korea is actually, it's plastic surgery is very common there.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
At least in the metropolitan areas. That's what I understand to be the case.
I think it's like the top in the world. I think everyone gets like, I think like as a graduation present, most people, but like no matter who you are, son, daughter, whatever, you get plastic surgery as a graduation present.
Gosh, that's sad.
Yeah. Right? So my question was, if you could have plastic surgery and reinvent your face completely, would you do it? So you could have the most, everything you've ever wanted in a face, but you would have to change your face almost to the point where you don't recognize, where you don't recognize yourself. Would you do it?
Do I go first?
I guess, you know, anyone, if anyone wants to chime in. Or
I can, yeah, I've always wanted more facial hair. Yeah, for as long as I could live, like
you have beautiful facial hair.
But you have like beautiful hair on your head.
Yeah, on my head.
Now you're just being greedy because you've got so many beautiful.
It just makes me feel like not Arab enough. I feel like I need
that. You've got that amazing mustache goatee.
Yeah, I barely have a goatee, man. It's not like it doesn't connect. But yeah, that's I've always wanted like a beard. You know, like I don't feel as Saudi. You know, with this like baby butt cheek.
I'd say it's better than to have a beard that doesn't fully grow, patchy.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Like I've got a patchy facial hair and sometimes I'm like, you know what, maybe it would have been better if I just couldn't grow it at all. But anyway, that's my so you would only just add facial hair, but I'm talking about like changing it to a
Is that plastic surgery though, if you're just, that would be like,
I don't know, it's more of like trip to Turkey, could, not so
yeah, yeah. Like if you could wake up looking like, I don't know, Brad Pitt or
like change my face,
just like the most beautiful person you can think of. Completely reinvent your face. But that the downside supposedly is that when you look in the mirror you don't see anything that reminds you of how what your face originally looks like. Would you do it?
I would probably not do it because as human beings we tend to want what we don't have. So you can have, or like, you know, you think that changing your face or becoming more objectively beautiful would like make your life better, and then you would have that surgery and yet you would still have issues, you would still have problems. Like it would not change the like the human experience of like suffering and feeling sad. And if you don't feel beautiful and you feel like people don't, you know, don't give you the time of day, you will have surgery, be beautiful, but then you will notice that people are taking advantage of you because they think you're beautiful. So it's like the different side of the coin that you would then have to like deal with.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel like I've come to the stage of my life where I accept myself for who I am. Plus, like, my face was never really the thing that I was like, that's what I want to change. It was always like my abilities as a person that I was like, I wish I was better at this, or I wish I wasn't as shit at this, rather than my physical appearance.
Sure, sure.
Yeah. So like if the question is would I change the way I look, no.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
What about you?
A lot of body positivity. I like it. Yeah. I said no because I think, well, I was thinking about it. I think it's, even though I have frequently been someone in my life where I'm like, gosh, I wish I had that differently, or I wish I looked more like that. I wish I looked more like that.
I mean, if you asked me like 10 years ago, for sure, I would have been like, yeah, like I get no. But
yeah,
like,
yeah, sure. But then also, like, but sorry,
you go ahead.
No. I mean, it's just, I guess it would be important. It would be difficult for me to reckon with not recognizing the man that's looking back at the man in the mirror.
No.
But I would really struggle with that. Even though I wonder if you change your face completely, you'd still see, because you know how like you still see like a 10-year-old version of yourself when you look in the mirror?
Yeah.
Anyway.
But not even that. Like, we are our harshest critics. Like, when you look at yourself in the mirror, all you see is flaws. Other people don't see that because you're the one seeing your face from different kind of lights. So, like, we are not reliable in our own beauty. Because you know what they say, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. And, like, when you're looking at yourself, if you're being critical, that is biased towards yourself.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And your perception of yourself is subjective as well.
Yeah, so and you might have surgery and you might still not like how you look. So it's
true. And you could end up like the Ken man, you know? The
yeah.
Ken doll guy. Have you seen the pictures of him?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or like the Bieber guy, like so yeah. many, you know.
Totally.
Like even celebrities now, when you like look at their faces, they are all just like merging into one face kind yeah. of thing. Like yeah. the same features and the same yeah, things, yeah. you know.
I mean, you see it just on the street in the UK, like yeah. in London, like everyone has like either Kim Kardashian face or like with men, everyone wants to kind of have that like angular, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's a specific type of
person. Or they want the cum gutters.
Yeah. And you know what?
The what?
Cum gutters.
What are cum
gutters? You don't know what a cum gutter is?
No.
Do you want to know?
Do I?
It's when you have the...
Oh, is it the V-shape?
The V-shape around your crotch. Oh, the cum gutters.
Yeah.
Sorry, I had to work that in somehow.
That's horrible.
Sorry, were you going to say anything else? Or
No.
Okay, let's... What's, I think we should...
Yeah,
we
should.
Oh, no, I think I was going to say something, but yeah, let's just...
All right, let's finish with ratings then, shall we?
Oh, is it... Do we still have to give an object?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Okay. 8 out of 10 cat turds.
Nice, well done. Cat turds.
I was going to go... 7.5 knives.
Oh, nice, because he has the knives in his flat.
Yeah, the little safe thing.
Yeah. I'll give this 10 out of 10.
Oh my god, yeah, it was the same as last week, too. I picked knives for Old Boy.
Oh, yeah, you did.
Yeah,
oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, knives on the mind. But I'll give it 10 out of 10 abandoned greenhouses.
Okay.
I just feel it's a flat out masterpiece. So nice. Thank you so much for... watching this movie and letting me ramble on about it.
Yeah. No, I think this has been our best theme in terms of like ratings that we've given. I think it might be our highest rated theme. Mm. But yeah, I think this was, I'm just going to give my thoughts on the theme itself because this is the last film. I really loved Korean New Wave. I really loved French New Wave. I think we just got to do more foreign films.
Hell yeah.
Lithuanian new wave, everybody. Oh. If that exists, I don't know.
If you want to come on be a guest, to guest host a theme.
Yeah.
Apologies.
I don't know if there's like enough actually good, like decent movies, but we could do something with that.
Or Baltic cinema?
I mean, I don't know any Latvian or Estonian films. So.
Fair.
Yeah. We'll find something.
Yeah.
We'll find something. But yeah, I think one of the main things that I've noticed is that the conversations that we speak of is like completely different to basically, or let me say it this way. Western films, and when I say Western, I mean like English language films. I feel like we're predisposed to expect a certain thing. So like having a Hollywood ending or coming to the fact that, oh, this person murdered Hamie, for sure. You know, that there's no kind of like ending point. I feel that's more common in a lot of foreign films. Like I was speaking to a friend the other day about French New Wave, and I feel like a lot of those films ended on a question rather than like a... this is the answer to this film. This is how you're rewarded. And same with like this Korean New Wave, like with Memories of Murder, it kind of ended on a question. With Old Boy, it's pretty set out, but it even still...
The ending is ambiguous.
The ending is quite ambiguous. Sure you're not sure what's going on. Like, does the daughter know or not? Or like if it was all real or not? And it's the same with this film. You're kind of just like questioning it a lot more, and it's leaving a lot more to the brain or to your mind. So, yeah, you know what? More foreign films. I think we need to do more foreign films,
And we definitely need to have Naringa on more as well.
For sure.
And more female stories as well.
Yeah,
actually, Naringa did point that out to me. She did say we did the female gaze. This is the conundrum we've created for ourselves, where we want to do more female-led films or films from female filmmakers. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I said film a lot there. But then we also loved having women on more to talk about these films so they could speak about it with more authority than we could, or with like more lived experience.
But not even
could.
That, just I said like more like, you know, movies like Tar, for example, or like just more like
I'd
like
love to talk
strong
about Tar.
Female characters and like less things where it's just like it seems like it's all about men. Not that it's bad, but again, there's so much
of
that.
I mean, we have talked about Scott Pilgrim. We have talked about Eternal Sunshine. And now we've talked about this film. Those are three films where the Manic Pixie Dream Girl, we were talking about that earlier. Yeah, where
they're all your choices, aren't they?
Oh, all right, we should end it here, guys. Come on.
No, I mean, like, if we consider, like, the last few films, we had Agnes Varda.
Yeah,
I mean, Korean
true.
New Wave might have been a tough one with
female.
With
watch?
Cleo from 5 to 7.
Oh, yeah.
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 And then we did Barbie, which is, I don't know if you'd consider that like female led or.
Oh,
like,
totally.
Yeah.
Or feminist. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, like, we've tried to be as mindful as possible, but I thought we were doing well in the last few months. My biggest issue is we don't have enough LGBTQ stories or voices on this podcast. And the issue is that with as three straight men, two of whom are two white straight men, it's hard to just talk about films like that without having the representation.
You've said that so much better than I was. You've said exactly what I was trying to say before. And I don't think we need to have a woman in the room, so to speak, or a femme person in the room to talk about a film that was made with strong female characters. You're completely right. But when it comes to LGBTQ or female gays or queer cinema, I think it's important sometimes to have someone.
It's because like for this film, we were like, oh, we haven't explored Asian films in a while. Let's go to Korea. Like for me, I wanted to do Palestinian films, you know, but I feel uncomfortable speaking about the Palestinian voice. Although I am Arab and I am close to what's going on, I still feel I need Palestinians. So it has to fit in with the, I don't know, with the planning and stuff like that. But I completely agree with you.
Yeah.
I completely agree with you.
And again, it's less like, oh, like every person on the crew or something has to be female. It's more about the realness or like accurate representation of like those characters, because you know there's again a lot of like great movies from like, you know, 20-30 years ago that are all good, but a lot of the times the women characters lack things, and I think that not that it's wrong, but you see so many of like these amazing male stories and male characters, like sometimes you're just like, well, let's talk about all the great women characters out
for
there.
for sure. Yeah, I completely agree.
Well, I think then we just need to have more guests like yourself coming back to I think pick films like that as well, I think we need to be recommended great films that do have legitimate three-dimensional authentic female characters.
After we did the female gaze theme, I've always tried to at least out of one movie out of all the three to have a strong female character. Yeah.
Oh, that's something I will try and do more going forward, because I realize I'm probably one of the main offenders when it comes to this male-dominated narrative focus.
Well, on that note, thank you for listening, everyone. Thank you to Naringa for being the amazing guest that she is, as usual. Thank you for picking this theme, Ollie. It was honestly a huge pleasure. I really loved Korean film. Like Korean New Wave, and I need to get my ass on more Korean films. I need to watch way more. What's that one? Something to Busan?
Train to Busan.
Train to Busan.
Yeah, that's a great
one. I haven't seen that.
That's a zombie film.
Yeah.
But it's not too scary, so I think you'd enjoy it.
I think, I'm more of a jump
it's
scare.
Not too scary.
You can handle it.
Jump scares are the
things
that get
me. Have
you seen it?
No. Yeah. Oh, you'd love it as well. Yeah.
Well then, when we do the zombie theme.
I'll be there. I do love my zombies.
Yeah. Zombie, zombie, zombie.